My ancient faith teaches me that all men are created equal.
These words were spoken by one of the greatest presidents our country has ever had. On the 12th day of February in the year 1809, a baby boy came into the world in a small log cabin near Hodgeville, Kentucky. His proud father, Tom Lincoln, looked at his new son and said,
"Nancy, let's name him Abraham after my father, Abraham. He was a good man."
"That's a good name, Tom. Belonged to a great leader, too. Abraham in the Bible. Who knows? Maybe our little Abe will be a great leader."
"Well, first of all, he's going to have to grow up and help me on the farm. Little Abe's got a long row to hoe before he'll have time to lead anybody."
Tom Lincoln was a poor man and uneducated. All he knew how to do was to work his farm in order to keep his wife, Nancy, and his two children, Sally and Abe, alive. Then one day, Tom Lincoln came home and he announced,
"Nancy, I've sold the farm."
"You sold a farm? Where are we going to live?"
"In Indiana."
"Indiana?
Tom, are you taking leave of your senses? That must be 100 miles away."
"Nancy, I heard there's rich farmland there, and you can buy it for $2 an acre. Come on now, we got to start packing. I want us out of here before the cold weather sets in."
When the Lincolns arrived at Pigeon Creek in Indiana, there was a lot of work to do. Little Abe worked side by side with his father, chopping down the tall trees, and then they set about building a log cabin. It was only one room, and it didn't have any windows. The floor was dirt, and there were no beds, just piles of dry leaves to sleep on. But Nancy was so happy to be living in a real house, and she didn't mind working by candlelight all day long. So the Lincolns passed their first year in Indiana. But then a plague came to Pigeon Creek and afflicted many settlers. It was called the milk sickness. Abe's mother come down with it bad, and since there was no doctor nor medicine anywhere around, Nancy Lincoln died. The bottom fell out of Abe's world. He had loved his mother so much. Tom Lincoln and his children tried to keep house and cook and tend the farm, but as the days and weeks went by, their faces grew thinner, their clothes shabbier, and the cabin dirtier. Then one morning, Tom Lincoln took off for a few days, and when he returned, he was sitting in a wagon drawn by 4 horses. Beside him sat a smiling woman holding a small boy in her lap, and behind her stood 2 young girls. As they drew closer, Tom Lincoln shouted,
"Whoa there! Well, here we are, Sari. Abe, Sally, I brought you a new ma and some brothers and sisters, too. Here, Sari, let me help you down."
"Thank you."
"This is your new home and family."
"Well, I declare. Y'all look as though you haven't had a bite to eat since Christmas. Think the best thing we better do now is get some victuals ready, and I'm sure everybody'd feel better. Come on now, everybody. There's work to do."
Abe's and Sally's new mother was someone Tom Lincoln had known in Kentucky. Her husband had died, and so he had gone to find out if she would come and be a mother to his 2 children. Sarah was pleased to find a new life for herself. So they were married, and their 2 families come together. Sarah Lincoln was a good mother. She kept the house clean and lively. Best of all, Sarah Lincoln discovered the brightness in Abraham and knew he should be getting some schooling. But Abe's father said,
"Schooling's silly and a waste of time, and Abe should spend his time with his chores on the farm."
But Sarah went out and Abe went to school, 8 miles away. Well, books were hard come by, but he read everything he could get his hands on, the Bible, Pilgrim's Progress, Robinson Crusoe, Aesop's Fables. That is, when he wasn't working in the fields or in the woods. He learned to handle all kinds of tools, and his body was growing tall and strong. Oh, he was the best wrestler in town, won all the running contests, broad jumps, and could pitch a crowbar further than anyone around. By the time he was 17, he had learned a lot and he'd grown to be 6 feet 4 inches tall. He began to work for other farmers in the neighborhood and gave his father his wages. Everyone liked him because he was a conscientious worker, and he was full of wit and good humor. And then the school he'd been attending several weeks during each year came to an end. Abraham was asked to read a speech at the closing exercises. Afterwards, he and his stepmother walked home together. Sarah said...
Oh, I was right proud of you today, Abe. I declare, what's ailing you? You look mighty down in the mouth for a boy who spoke his piece so well on the last day.
I've been thinking how this is the last day I'll ever go to school, most likely. And I ain't even had a year of schooling all told. I can't even speak proper.
Seems to me like you're giving yourself a mighty fine education with all them books you keep reading.
Ma, that's the whole trouble. I've read every book for miles around. I've been thinking about going away.
Going away? Well, where would you go?
Well, any place where I could meet new people and find new books. I can't help it, Ma. I want to get away.
It wasn't long before Abe got his chance to get away. One of the farmers he worked for hired him to help him on a flatboat taking the cargo down to New Orleans. To a boy brought up in the backwoods, it was a real adventure to sail 700 miles down the Mississippi River. New Orleans was the first big city he'd ever seen. And Abe's eyes grew wide and his mouth fell open as he gawked at ladies and gentlemen in fancy clothes. And for the first time in his life, he saw Negroes in chains being sold in the slave market. Abe could not believe that human beings were actually sold like cattle. And this sight and this feeling stayed with him the rest of his life. When he returned to Pigeon Creek, Abe learned that his family was leaving Indiana and moving further west to Illinois, a new frontier, out of the woods and onto the prairies. Not long after they had settled in Illinois, Abe met a man who wanted to hire him as a clerk in his store in New Salem. His father didn't like the idea, but Abe was 21 now and on his own. The morning he left, he said goodbye to his family, and then his stepmother walked down to the gate with him. He looked at her for a long time, tenderly.
You just believe in yourself, Abe. God bless you.
Abe kissed her quickly and ran down the road toward his new life in New Salem. Abe went to work in Mr. Offutt's store, selling everything from ladies' hats and coats to sugar, tea, and coffee. The townspeople were quite awed by this long and lanky backwoodsman who could actually write his name, which none of them could do. They were drawn to his good humor and the stories and the jokes he always had ready. He was also admired and respected for his honesty and integrity. In those first years in New Salem, Abe went to war against the Indians. He came back and became postmaster. He worked as a land surveyor, and he was elected to the legislature. Honest Abe, his friends called him. He opened a store of his own in New Salem, and one day a farmer drove up in a loaded wagon. He came into the store and he said,
"Hey there, young man. We're moving out and we're so crowded I gotta get rid of this barrel. Give me 50 cents and you can have it."
"I'll pay you 50 cents for it, mister."
The barrel turned out to be a treasure chest for Abe Lincoln, because down in the bottom, he found a big, thick book called Blackstone's Commentaries, the most important law book ever printed. That first day, Abe read 40 pages of it.